So today's lecture on DC machines is on DC motor. So last few lecture we have covered DC generator, its construction, working principle, and how the armature windings are there, some EMF equation, its types and others. So let us start with DC motor. In DC generator, you know that there is some generated EMF which is in accordance with Faraday's law, and its direction is being given by the Lenz law. So in DC motor, this generated EMF is sometimes, or rather most of the times, it is told to be EB, that is the back EMF. Now what is back EMF in a DC motor and what is its significance, that we will see. So you know that an armature is rotating in the magnet, and you have the magnetic MMF FM, and you have a rotation which is at the angular speed omega. So there will be a generated EMF in the armature EB whose resistance is RA, and you know that the EB equation is being given as, or the generated equation is given by 5 PN by 60 into Z by A, whereas in case of your motor, EB is equal to V minus IAR. So this equation is corresponding to the KVL equation, and this equation is the general equation of the generated EMF. Now why it is told to be back EMF and what is its significance, that we are going to discuss. So when there is a current carrying conductor, now you have a current carrying conductor, so these are the conductors which are present in the armature, so it is carrying a current I. So it will be establishing a magnetic flux density. So whenever there is a current carrying conductor, it will have a flux associated with it, and it will be having a flux density. So due to which there will be a induced torque. So there will be an induced torque, and this permanent magnet or the main poles are basically creating the main flux, which is interacting with the current carrying conductors, and due to which a torque is produced in the armature. Due to the production of the torque, there is rotating of the conductor which is cutting the flux. So the conductor which is there in the armature, it is basically rotating and it is cutting the flux which is generated by the main field poles. Then a EMF is induced in the armature which can be tapped with the help of load current, with the help of load. But it is a DC motor, so obviously you will be having mechanical power developed at the output. Now the generated EMF is the induced one. Now direction of the induced EMF is opposite to the supply voltage, because that is the cause. So we have studied the Lenz law, and there we have seen that the direction of the induced EMF in the armature will be opposing the cause for which it is produced. So the cause is basically the voltage, because it is electrical energy is converted to mechanical energy in DC motor. So electrical energy, which is the voltage, is the cause which it has to oppose. Now, since the generated EMF in the armature is opposing the supply voltage, then it is known as the counter or the back EMF. So the generated EMF which is opposing the supply voltage, it is known as the counter or back EMF. Now, EB, which is the back EMF, is in series with the supply voltage. It is in series with the supply voltage, but it is opposing the direction. So in terms of the direction of the voltage, the back EMF is opposing the supply voltage. So the current which is produced is also opposing it. So the current which is produced will be also opposing the supply, the back EMF. Then we will be having this KVL equation, EB is equal to V minus IARA. Now, what is the advantage of back EMF? Why back EMF is necessary, and what is the advantage, that we will see. So, In motor, we give electrical energy and take out mechanical energy, and the mechanical energy is being developed in the rotor of the armature, which is given by EB into IA. So this is basically the power which is generated in the armature, which is being tapped in the shaft. So the electrical to mechanical energy conversion is possible only because if there should be a back EMF. So the back EMF is very important. Otherwise, the power developed in the mechanical energy format in the rotor EB into IA will not be there. So this electrical power which is being developed in the rotor of the armature will not be tapped in the shaft as the mechanical energy. So this is the first point. Second point is EB makes DC motor self-regulating. So what is the meaning of self-regulating? That we will see. So the back EMF is making the DC motor self-regulating. Now if you write down the equation of the current in case of the DC motor from the KVL equation, so from the KVL equation we can get what is the value of the current. So current is basically the supply voltage minus the back EMF divided by the resistance of the armature. So what happens when there is no load? So if no load is connected to the shaft of the armature, then it will require a small torque. So if load is not there, obviously the torque requirement will be small. And for controlling the friction and the windage losses, there will be a small amount of the torque. Then it will withdraw the less current. So when under the condition that no load is there, the motor will draw a less amount of current. So less amount of current if the motor has to draw, then from this equation we can find that the back EMF will be less because the supply voltage is constant and resistance of the armature is also constant. We can't change the supply voltage because it is coming from directly from the mains, and the resistance of the armature is from the construction, so that is also fixed. So basically we can see that current should be proportional to the back EMF. So in case of no load condition, since torque requirement is less, obviously the motor will draw less amount of current, and if the motor is drawing less amount of current, obviously the back EMF will be less. Second point, if you see that if the load increase, now since the load increase, then what will happen? The load torque, which is denoted by TL, will be more than the motor torque. So load torque will be more than the motor torque. In that case, what will happen? The speed of the armature will decrease. So with the increase in the load, the speed falls. Now you know that the relation between speed and back EMF is, speed is directly proportional to back EMF by flux. So obviously speed is directly proportional to back EMF. Then if the speed is falling because of the increase in the load, obviously the back EMF will also fall because they are directly proportional to each other. Then the back EMF will fall. Due to the fall of the back EMF, you can see from this equation, so current equation and the back EMF equation, the current will increase. So there will be increase in the current. So if the current increase, then the torque will increase because torque is related with the current. So with the increase in the current, torque increase. That is the reason this motor is known as self-regulating motor, and back EMF is controlling the load of the motor. So back EMF is controlling the load. So with the change in the load, the back EMF will change, governing the current. Now vice versa, if you take that the load on the motor is decreasing, so if the load on the motor is decreasing, obviously the motor torque will be more than the load torque, and the speed of the armature will increase. So if the speed of the armature is increasing, obviously from this relationship, speed directly proportional to back EMF, so back EMF will also increase. So if back EMF is increasing, So you can see that current will decrease because from this relationship it will be opposing the current. So this is in accordance with the Lenz law. So back EMF is increasing, obviously the current will decrease. Here I have given directly proportional, do not confuse. This is in accordance with the magnitude, but in accordance with the Lenz law, current is opposing the back EMF. So back EMF is increasing, so current will decrease, and obviously there will be a decrease in the torque. So again, it is the same thing, that back EMF is regulating the motor. So what happened, that whenever a motor is loaded, if it is load more or load less, there is no load condition or more load condition in the rated current, then the armature current is changing. So the armature current is changing with respect to the load condition, and this armature current is changing the back EMF, and back EMF is again controlling the torque of the motor. So whenever the load will be more, the speed will fall, and again with the help of this current and the back EMF, the motor will again gather the speed. So this is the advantage of the back EMF. Now let us describe what is the condition for maximum power in the motor, when the power is maximum. So you can see the equation of the power. Power is given by V into IA minus IAR square. So this is basically the copper loss. So this is basically the copper loss in the armature, and this is the developed power in the armature. So the net power, whatever we will having, is basically the generated power or the back EMF power minus the copper loss that is there in the armature. So the power has to be maximum. So this power has to be maximum under the condition that the power differentiation with respect to the armature current should be equal to zero, we'll put it. Then if you differentiate this equation of the power equation, we are getting V minus 2 IARA. Now here from this equation, you can put the equal to is IARA is equal to V by 2. That is the total voltage drop. So IARA is basically the total voltage drop in the armature of the rotor or the machine or the DC motor will be equal to half of the supply voltage. Then the power will be maximum. So this condition is important. So the copper loss, voltage drop in the armature copper loss, should be half of the supply voltage. Now if you substitute that in the KVL equation, V equal to EB plus IARA, then you will be getting that EB, IARA, you put it V by 2, then you will get that EB should be equal to V by 2. So your back EMF should be half of the supply voltage. So this is the condition that we get for the maximum power. Next, we will describe the torque equation of a DC motor. So how the torque equation of a DC motor is there? So we have seen the power equation. So this is the power equation, and when the power is maximum condition, now we will go for the torque equation. So we have seen that the torque of a DC motor is being controlled with the armature current when there is a change in the load. So with the change in the load, armature current changes, and armature current is basically controlling the back EMF, and that is controlling the torque. So we can write the equation, power in the motor is basically back EMF into armature current, and in mechanical term we can write it is the torque into omega. Omega is the speed, angular speed in radian per second. So omega is radian per second. So the equation of the power PM is equal to EB into IA, where EB is the back EMF and IA is the armature current, is equal to torque into omega. Then you can substitute the value of EB as 5PN by 60 into Z by A, and you can substitute the omega value here. in terms of the RPM 2 pi n by 60. So on the left hand side of the equation, you substitute what is Eb we have, and on the right hand side of the equation, you substitute what is the value of the omega in terms of the speed in RPM. Then after proper substitution, you can get what is the torque in the DC motor. So the torque in the DC motor, you will be getting the equation as 1 by 2 pi 5 pz by A into the armature current. So this equation has to be remembered. What is the torque equation? If you can't remember this equation, you can easily find the torque equation from the power equation. Okay, so if you find out the constant, what are the constant that you have in the torque equation, you will find that the torque is directly proportional to flux into armature current. So the developed torque is directly proportional to flux into armature current. Whereas the next other terms, whatever you have is basically constant, because the number of poles will be constant, number of conductors will be constant, number of parallel path will be constant, and this is also a constant. So the torque is dependent on the flux of the machine and the armature current. So what happened then for the torque? Let us see what happened for the torque. Now this equation of the torque, whatever we have described, that equation is basically armature torque. So this equation is armature torque. However, this torque is not available in the shaft, but there will be some mechanical loss due to the friction and the windage loss, which we have to subtract from the developed armature torque to get the shaft torque. So shaft torque is basically the actual torque which is available on the shaft. So our armature torque, which is developed minus the mechanical loss, friction and the windage loss, will give you the shaft torque. Now let us see the characteristic of the torque for different motor, like series motor and shunt motor. So what happened in the series motor and what happened in the shunt motor? So you have to remember this equation: torque is proportional to flux into armature current, and you know that flux will be always proportional to the field current. So in case of your series motor, you know that the field is flux, which is proportional to field current, is proportional to the armature current, because in series motor your series current is equal to armature current. So what is the meaning? This, the flux is proportional to the armature current. So here if you put armature current in the torque equation, you will get torque is proportional to the square of the armature current. It means if you increase the armature current 2 times, the torque will increase 4 times. So that is the reason a precaution has been told in the experiment. Whenever you are performing in the lab, one precaution has been told that series motor should not be started under no load condition. So series motor should not be started under no load condition. What will happen at the no load condition? At the no load condition, your armature current will be high, and obviously the torque will be tremendously high, and the machine will rotate at a very high speed. So that is the reason we should not start the series motor under no load condition. Now let us see for the shunt motor. You know that shunt motor is basically a constant flux motor. So in the shunt motor, your flux remains the constant and load do not have any impact on the shunt motor, because its speed is also constant. It is not dependent on the load. So here if you take the flux constant in the torque equation, you will get torque is proportional to the armature current. So here you get torque is proportional to the square of the armature current. Here you are getting torque is proportional to the armature current. So this is a quadratic equation, this is a linear equation. So for series motor and shunt motor, torque performance is different, and that governs the application. So that governs the application of the DC motor, whether you want to use the DC motor as the shunt motor or series motor. Now we will describe the speed of the DC motor. So we have learned the power and the torque. Now the next thing that we are going to see is the speed. So speed of the DC motor. So in the DC motor, we can write the KVL equation. KVL equation is the back EMF is equal to the supply voltage minus the drop across the armature. So this is the very simple equation of the KVL equation, considering that we have taken a shunt motor. So this we have considered a shunt motor, a basic equation. Okay. Now in this equation, if we substitute what is the value of the back EMF, you know the famous back EMF equation 5PN60 into Z by A that you put, so it will be equal to V minus IARA. So we have substituted the value of the back EMF in the equation of the KVL. So we get 5PN by 16 into Z by A equal to V minus IARA. Now here we have the term which is the speed. So we have to take out the speed from the equation. So if you take out the speed from the equation, you will get V minus IARA by flux into 60A by ZB. You know all the terms. IA is the armature current, RA is the armature resistance, phi is flux per pole, A is the number of parallel path which is dependent upon whether it is a lap winding or a wave winding, Z is the total number of armature conductors, and P is the number of poles. Now from this equation, on the numerator side, we know V minus IARA can be written as EB. So speed can be written as EB by phi into 60 by A into ZP divided by ZP. So if you see this part of the equation, it is basically a constant. It is basically a constant because these are all specific to the construction of the DC motor. So we can write that the speed of the DC motor is equal to some constant into EB by phi. So speed is directly proportional to the back EMF, and speed is directly inversely proportional to the flux. So if you remember, in the third experiment in the lab, you are performing the speed control, right? In the third experiment, you are basically performing the speed control of the DC motor, where you have two different methods. What is known as the armature control, and other is known as the field control. So two different ways by which you can control the speed of the DC motor. So this speed directly proportional to back EMF is known as the armature control method. Speed inversely proportional to flux is known as the field control method. So whenever you are controlling the speed with respect to the armature control, you keep the field current constant. If you want to control the speed with respect to field, you keep the armature voltage constant. Okay. Second thing is that this equation speed is equal to KEB by phi is a very important equation. So given a particular speed N1, so if you are given a particular speed N1, you can find out what is N2, that is at what speed, at some other speed the motor is rotating, using the relation N2 by N1 is equal to EB2 by EB1 into phi1 by phi2, where N1 is for the first case and second is for the second case. And so under two different conditions, if you know the back EMF and the flux, obviously you can relate the speed at the two different conditions. And the phi1 by phi2 condition, you can substitute as IA1 by IA2 condition, because here your flux will be proportional to the armature current. So that you can put to find out the speed of the DC motor. Now let us understand, we have understood what is power, we have understood what is torque, we have understood what is speed. So three things we have understood. Then what is the relationship between two quantities, that is torque and speed? So what is the relationship between the torque of a DC motor and the speed of the DC motor? So let us see. So in order to understand this relationship torque and speed, you have to remember these two particular equation. That is, speed is equal to directly proportional to back EMF and inversely proportional to flux. So speed is equal to KEB by phi, and torque is directly proportional to flux into armature current. So these are the fundamental equations that you have to remember to understand the relationship between torque and speed. Now let us see the first condition. So armature torque is a function of flux and armature current, but independent of speed. So that is a very important point. Your torque, which is the function, you can see it is a function of flux and armature current, but it is independent of speed. Torque do not depend upon the speed. Now second point, speed depends on torque and not vice versa. So here the term not is used. So torque do not depend upon the speed, but speed depends upon the torque. Okay, so speed depends upon the torque. Now let us see the third point. Suppose a condition is there where you have an increase in the flux. So your flux is increased. So if the flux is increasing, what happened to the speed? So if the flux is increasing, obviously your speed will fall. Obviously your speed will fall. But what happened to the armature torque then? Armature torque should be not possible, because it is not possible for the falling in a speed to increase in the armature torque. That is not possible, because torque always tend to produce rotation, because the main work of the torque is to produce the rotation. So the falling in the speed can't increase the torque, which is not possible. So if torque is increasing, speed must increase rather than decrease. Okay, so here you can understand that flux, if you are increasing, your speed which is falling will not allow the torque to increase, because it will contradict. Hence we say that torque is independent of the speed, but speed is dependent on torque and not vice versa. Now these we have taken, but under what is actually happening in the motor? So in order to understand that, we have to understand the following sequence. So let us understand the sequence, what is happening in the motor. So suppose the flux is decreasing. Now let us consider the case one, that flux is decreasing. So if the flux is decreased, then what will happen in the motor? The field current will decrease, because the field current is proportional to the flux. So flux decrease means field current decrease. Now your back EMF is proportional to the speed into flux, and since flux is decreasing, obviously the back EMF will fall. So back EMF will fall, and speed is constant due to the inertia of the heavy armature. So even the field current falls and flux falls, your speed is not changing, it is constant, because your armature is quite heavy due to the inertia. Now due to the fall in the back EMF, what happened to the armature current then? So the back EMF is falling, then the armature current will increase from the relationship V minus EB by RA, because in this condition you know that V and RA we will not touch, because they are mostly constant. So if the EB is falling, then the armature current will increase in accordance with the Lenz law, because they are opposing each other, V and EB. And moreover, we know that with the decrease in the flux, there will be quite increase in the armature current. So flux is decreasing and there will be too much increase in the armature current. And torque is proportional to the flux into armature current. So flux decrease is counterbalanced by increase in the, too much increase in the armature current, resulting in increase in the torque. So there is increase in the torque. So this relationship with the increase in the torque, speed increases, is justified. So this is justified from this sequence, whatever. So here you have to remember that the torque is independent of the speed, but speed will depend on the torque. And to understand the dynamics of the machine, what is happening, you have to just remember few equations, and from there you can deduce the sequence what is happening. So you are having the flux falls, your field current will fall, and if the field current is falling, what happened to the back EMF? The back EMF is fall because of the decrease in the flux, because speed will remain constant due to the inertia of the motor, inertia of the heavy armature, and there is decrease in the back EMF, then armature current will increase because of the opposite counterbalance of the back EMF and the voltage, and the decrease in the flux will too much increase in the armature current, and that will counterbalance both. So we can define that increase in torque is increasing the speed. Now the final things that we will see is for today's class is what is speed regulation. So this is important because some numerical will be there on speed regulation. So speed regulation is basically defined as what is the change in the speed when the load on the motor is reduced from rated value to zero. So you have some, this is your motor, this is your motor, and you have been connected with a shaft, and this is your load. So you have the load connected on the motor. So what happened if this load is changed from the rated condition to the no load condition? Rated condition means at full load. Rated condition means at full load. So under full load, you will be having full load current drawn in the armature. So when the load is quickly changed from the rated condition to the no load condition, then the ratio that we are changing, the difference in the speed from the no load to the full load condition, and the reference we are taking to the full load condition, that is a full load speed, that ratio multiplied with 100 we can take to have defined the percentage is known as the speed regulation. So speed regulation is basically the ratio of the change in the speed when the motor load is changed from the rated condition to the no load condition, and the reference is taken as the full load speed. So if you multiply it with 100, obviously you will get a percentage. So that is known as speed regulation. So here in this particular lecture, we have focused our discussion on the dynamics of the DC motor, where we have covered the power, torque, speed, relationship between the various quantities, flux, armature current, speed, and how the torque and speed are changing. Otherwise, what is the relationship, and how the series and shunt motor are related in respect of the torque and armature current.